The first is that it's clear that Biden, at least on the question of the relationship with China, is on a similar course to Trump. And so far there's not much difference in the approach. This is not surprising because the rise of anti-China opinion in America has essentially been consensual and bipartisan. So what we're witnessing, I suppose, is what we've been seeing for quite a while so far. But he has one difference, one notable difference, at least several differences, but one notable difference is that Biden, unlike Trump, is essentially anxious to reconstruct a multilateral relationship with the other Western nations and seek, above all, to make China as the central target in relationship to this. Now, I don't think and Biden in some ways so far, you know, has been introduced a new tone into the situation. But of course, his vulnerability is very clear. He could lose his majority in the next congressional election, in which case most of his economic program, a lot of it, will go up in flames. And lurking in the background, of course, of American politics is what happened with Trump and the situation where the country is deeply divided. So America is, you know, America has got deep problems, which I think we're all very mindful of, but there's no harm in reminding ourselves of this. When he went, I think that what I want to stress here is the relative weakness of the United States in relationship to China. I think we shouldn't see this anything like a rerun of the last Cold War. This is a very, very different situation. And I, in a way, I think a classic illustration of this was the G7. Because if you look at the communique that was adopted at the end, it's clear that what Biden wanted, in key respects, Biden did not get. And the reason he didn't get it was there's an important number of European countries that see the situation very differently from the United States. Now, so when we get this talk of the Western alliance and so on, then we need to interrogate this, because on the one hand, there's the United States. What's the United States' great concern? The United States' great concern is the rise of China as a hegemonic alternative to the United States. In other words, a threat to American primacy. And that is the central issue, in my view, not just for Biden or Trump, but this is a consensual issue in the United States. Don't let go of our superior position in the world, our position of power. On the other hand, Europeans, increasingly, with exceptions like the UK, are on a different track, really. They have no hegemonic aspirations. They gave these up a long time ago. So what Europe is concerned about, above all, and this is best articulated by Angela Merkel, is a relationship, a cooperative relationship with China, which in the view of an increasing number of Europeans, is the key to European growth and prosperity. Now, these two positions are very different. And if you want to sort of extend this picture more globally, then if you look around the world, it's not just Europe that's making this calculation. It's many countries making this calculation. I mean, take American ally South Korea, for example. South Korea does not want to be dragged into an anti-China platform, an anti-China position. And of course, as Loki said, if you look around the world, then it's obvious that actually China has a much bigger trading imprint across the world than the United States. The United States is actually not a very big trader, really. Whereas China has a relationship with about 140 countries in the world, count China as their biggest trading partner. So this leads me to my final point, which is that we're not seeing a rerun of the last Cold War. This is a much more complicated situation. I mean, the last Cold War was essentially marked by two mutually exclusive blocs, profound military competition, and deep ideological schism. Now, I don't think this mood now and what America's up to can be characterized in the same way. Probably, I mean, we don't know yet, but I suspect that military competition will not occupy the same prominence as it did previously. What appears to be replacing this is a much wider range of issues. Wider because China's challenge to the United States actually is a huge challenge based on a very successful economy, very successful history, as Anna was pointing out, and so on. So China represents a totally different kind of challenge to the one that the Soviet Union represented. Now, the result of this, I think, is that it's, the other point I should add here is that China and the United States are both deeply integrated in the global economy. I mean, this just wasn't true of the Soviet Union. So in this case, the United, it's impossible, I think, to try and excise or sever China from the global economy. It would probably be easier to separate the United States actually from the global economy than it would China. So China is deeply integrated. So we're talking about a very different situation, it seems to me. And I think the result of that will not be a real, probably one can never be sure about these things, but not a very clear bifurcation of the world. But on the contrary, many countries will hedge, in my view. That's what Europe is doing. You know, it's getting on with the United States, but it wants to have a relationship with China, Italy, France, Germany, Greece, and so on. Likewise, if you look at, for example, in East Asia, Southeast Asia, where China actually is much more important economically than the United States, but no countries in Southeast Asia, apart from Singapore, perhaps Vietnam is a different sort of example altogether, are involved in any kind of security relationship with China. So China is the economic leader and shaper, and militarily, no, China hasn't gone down that road. So we, and this is, it seems to me, so basically you have a situation of hedging in Southeast Asia as well. 700 million people, never forget that, bigger than Europe, and extremely central, it seems to me, to what's likely to happen in the world. So therefore, the situation where, or the situation we're now in, which I expect to go on for a long time, I think that the era from 1972 to 2016 of relative cooperation between the United States and China is well over. And I don't see that being resuscitated anytime soon. I think, you know, let's think of 20-year horizon or something like this now. It's going to go on for a long time. But I think that the prospects as far as China concerned in this situation are very good. To finish with, I mean, never forget, America's the declining power and China is the rising power. Thank you.